morning to all of you. It's good to see you all this Sunday morning. I think we got a little break from the weather here. It made it a little easier for us all to get here. But what better place could we be than here together and serving the Lord, remembering His goodness to us. So good to see you all, and good to have those who are joining us by our live stream as well. We always begin our service with a call to worship, a scripture that will focus us on God and on important things in His Word. So today we're going to read a verse that centers on our theme, because He lives. It's in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 20-24. But now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ all shall be made alive, but each in his own order. Christ, the first fruits, after that those who are Christ at his coming. Then comes the end, when he delivers up the kingdom to the God and Father, when he has abolished all rule and all authority and power. That will be our theme today as we think about the resurrection of Christ. Let's have a word of prayer together before we begin our singing.
Our most righteous, great, and innocent Father, who is our rock, our shield, our fortress, and source of help and strength in times of trouble. Holy be your name. Our Father, we're thankful for all the many blessings, both spiritual and material, that you have so richly blessed us with. And we ask you to continue to bless us richly in the ways that you deem best. And help us to always use these blessings in a way that reflect honor and glory towards you. We're thankful for having this opportunity to come together and worship you this morning. And it's our prayer that our worship will be pleasing, acceptable in your sight. And help us always be thankful for having these opportunities to come together to worship you. We're thankful for the church here. We ask you to bless it. Help it to us to be an influence for good wherever our influence might be able to reach. Help us to bring honor and glory towards you. Our Father, we ask you to be with Johnny and Doug as they bring shepherd the flock here. Watch over them and help them make the decisions that would be best for the congregation here to grow both spiritually as well as numerically and be an influence for good. We're recognized that there is a need for laborers to work in your vineyard. And our Father, we ask you to use us in any way you deem best in your vineyard. Help us to be on the lookout for those who are seeking to serve you and to do what's right. And help us to have the wisdom and courage necessary to help bring more people into your kingdom. Our Father, we are especially thankful for what you and your Son and the Holy Spirit have done on our behalf in the sacrifice of Christ upon the cross so that we could have the forgiveness of our sins and have the hope of heaven. And help us to develop a greater appreciation and love and for what you and your Son and the Holy Spirit have done for us. And we're also thankful for the fact that Christ is alive, that he was raised from the dead, so that we can have that hope of heaven one day. We recognize that we do from time to time sin in your sight. And for these sins, the commission and omission, our Father, we ask for your forgiveness. And our Father, we ask you for help in developing courage, wisdom, and strength necessary to be able to withstand the snares of Satan places before us. We're thankful for our brethren. We're thankful for them, and we ask you for help in developing a greater love and appreciation and concern for one another. Our Father, we have a number of our congregation that's sick. We ask you to be with those and restore them to their natural walks of life as soon as possible with measure of health you need best, especially the ones that are listed in the bulletin and on the minds and hearts of the members here, as well as all who have asked for our prayers. Our Father, we ask you also to be those who are spiritually sick. Please help something be said and done and to bring them back to you. Our Father, we ask you to be the leaders of this country, this state, and this community. Help them to make decisions that would enable members of your body to live quiet and peaceful lives. And our Father, we ask you to help them make decisions that would lead this nation to paths of righteousness. And when they try to lead this nation to paths of unrighteousness, please defeat them in that. Our Father, we recognize that our cities and our nation is going through a great deal of turmoil at this time. Please help things to come about so that there can be civility among people today. Our Father, we recognize that we're about to have an election in a few months. Please help us to elect this nation, to elect the leaders that would lead this nation past righteousness. And our Father, we ask you to be with the ones who are trying to develop the care for this disease that's going around and help them make the decisions that would be best to bring it to a cure be found. Help others to see us or see you in us. Help us to be able to be an influence for good wherever our influence might be able to reach. Help us to create a thirst for you in our lives, among others. And our Father, we ask you for help in developing greater trust, confidence in you, and lean upon you in every aspect of our life. In the most holy name of your Son, we pray. Amen.
Over the past several months, we have looked methodically at the evidence for the resurrection of Jesus. We have seen that his resurrection from the dead is the culminating proof of our faith, as we have looked at the evidence the Gospels give us. But it's much more than a theoretical truth of the Gospel. Instead, it has a practical relevance to our lives every day. Because he lives, our lives can be changed forever. And today, in our sermon and song, we focus on what his resurrection means to us in a practical way. As always, Mark will lead us in our singing. We appreciate him doing that, taking the burden of leading so many songs. And we'll have a program that we're following in on the second page of the bulletin if you want to follow there or on the screen above me. But let us focus our attention on the resurrection today and on what it means to us. And let us join together in fervent worship to God, edifying one another by these wonderful songs. Many of our songs remind us powerfully of the truth of the resurrection, but none, I think, more than this one that we've sung so often. Lo, in the grave he lay.
Lo, in the grave he lay. Amen.
term that simply says, praise the Lord. And the reason we sing our hallelujahs is because of what is true, because He lives. And today we're going to think about that together. Because He lives, we have an irrefutable basis for our faith in Him as the Son of God. The resurrection is the culminating proof of Jesus' claims to be God in the flesh. Paul said that the gospel is a message concerning His Son, who was born of the descendant of David according to the flesh, was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead according to the Spirit of holiness. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Because He lives, we know who He is, that He is indeed the risen Son of God, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, our Lord. Let's sing about Him now.
Jesus is Lord, my Redeemer.
Yeah.
day you were baptized. It is commonly used as a post-baptismal hymn to remind us of what happened in that moment of baptism. Just think about that for a moment. Had it not been for what Jesus did, had it not been that he was raised from the dead, then the harsh reality of this song would be true. We would be dead in our sins, with no hope of eternal life, and headed for eternal judgment. But because he lives, we can live that new life. Christ can come and live in us. And I hope as we sing that, they will not only remember that we can be raised spiritually to a new life with him, but that we'll remember that's the kind of life we need to be living. One in which Christ, the living Savior, lives within us. Because he lives, we can be raised spiritually with him to a new life. But also, because he lives, we have been exalted to a new status as citizens of the kingdom of God. Paul wanted the Ephesians to understand that something remarkable had happened to them in their decision to follow Jesus. They had not only experienced that resurrection, the new life, that resurrection power of Jesus and being made alive from spiritual death, which we just sung about, but in addition, they had been, as Paul put it, seated with him in the heavenly places. He said, but God being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with him, by grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, in order that in the ages to come, he might show the surpassing riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. What does that mean? He seated us with him. Well, Paul explains in Romans 5, at least I think the concept behind this statement. He says, for if by the transgression of the one, that is Adam, death reigned through the one, much more those who receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, that is those who have believed and submitted to the gospel, will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. Think about what a unique place we have because he lives. That we have not only been raised from spiritual death, but we have been seated with him, Paul says, in heavenly places. We are citizens of his kingdom. We're soldiers in his army, and we are sharers in his victory. Because he lives, we can truly say, he's my king.
All day long of Jesus I am singing. He my soul from joy will ever be. All the while he keeps my heart a-ringing. For his love is everything to me. He is my king, and oh, I dearly love him. He is my king, no other is above him. All day long in rapture praise I sing.
Tells us to present his blood as the atoning sacrifice for our sin. He is able to save forever those who draw near to God through him, since he ever lives to make intercession for them. Think about the fact that because Jesus lives, we have the privilege of having an intercessor in heaven who has offered his own blood for our forgiveness. And whenever we need it, we know that he is there, pleading with the Father in our behalf, asking for our forgiveness because of what he has done. And what that also means is that we will never lose the help of our great high priest until the day that we reach the presence of God. Our high priest is alive and will ever live. And therefore, in our time of need, he will be there to hear us and to help us. And that's what the Hebrew writer tells us in chapter 4. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in all things as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore draw near with confidence to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Because he lives, we will always have a friend in heaven.
What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear.
Sing a song that will enable us to reflect upon has done, his story, and tie that story to what we're about to do as we break bread together. Mark, we will. Let's read, let's sing together this song, One Day, number 353. We'll sing all of the verses and then the chorus.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain, one day they nailed him to die on the tree, suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing my sins, my Redeemer is he. One day they left him alone in the garden, one day he rested from suffering free. Angels came down for his sin-drinking vigil, oh, of the hopeless, my Savior is he. One day the grave could conceal him no longer, one day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose over death he had conquered, now is ascended, my Lord evermore. One day the trumpet will sound for his coming, one day the skies with his glory will shine. Wonderful day, Jesus is mine. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified, breathing forever. One day he
sure that everyone has one of our Lord's Supper kits. Make sure if you don't have one, raise your hand. We'll see that you have that. There are different ways we can think about the Lord's Supper, but I believe that in view of the story that we just read, the Lord's Supper can relate to that story in multiple ways. In the first place, when we break bread, as we do each Lord's Day, we need to look back. Remembrance. Jesus himself said, do this in remembrance of me. We need to reflect upon the history of what happened at the cross, Jesus' life and death, his burial, his resurrection, his ascension, his reign in heaven, and think about all those things that have already transpired. But the Apostle Paul tells us that as we break bread on the Lord's Day, we also proclaim his death until he comes. And so that reminds us that not only should we look back with remembrance, we need to look forward with hope that our Lord is coming for his people, that he is reigning now in heaven, but that one day he will return, as we just sung. The trumpet will sound for his coming. What a beautiful picture we have. But in the meantime, there's another way we need to look. We need to look up. And we need to look up with gratitude every day, thinking about what we have because of what Jesus did. As we eat the bread and drink the fruit of the vine, let fruit of the vine. Let us look up in gratitude to God. And also, let us look within. The Scripture warns us, he who partakes of the bread and fruit of the vine unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of Christ. This is no mindless act. It is a serious and sobering reflection, and yes, even a joyful reflection upon what Jesus has done, but it must certainly not be mindless. Let us look within and make sure that our thoughts are where they need to be as we briefly eat this bread and drink this fruit of the vine. And finally, I submit that we also need to look around. We need to look around with love. Today, we're all holding in our hand this bread and fruit of the vine, but keep in mind that there are others around us who are holding that same bread and fruit of the vine, that we are, in fact, experiencing a communion, a sharing in the body and blood of Christ. Everyone, every believer in this building today holding the bread and the fruit of the vine in their hand is an equal guest to the table of the Lord, welcomed by Him. And therefore, they are our brothers and they are our sisters. They are part of the family. And thus, as we might gather around, for example, a Thanksgiving table with all of our relatives and acknowledging them all with love and appreciation, let us also today, as we break the bread and drink the fruit of the vine, look around with love. Let us give thanks to the Lord. Our Heavenly Father, we remember the words of the Lord when He gave the bread to His disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, do this in remembrance of me." We're grateful for this bread and for this memorial that you've left behind for us to help us week by week to never forget what you've done. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the body that was prepared for Him, that He might come to earth and that He might offer that body as a sacrifice for sin. We remember how much He suffered. We remember the anguish with which He approached His death. We remember the burden that He bore in carrying our sin. And we thank you so much for all of that as we eat this bread together. We pray in His name. Give thanks to Him for the fruit of the vine. Again, Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can gather together around this spiritual table with equal access to these elements, the acknowledgement of our brotherhood and of our relationship with you. And we especially now are mindful of His blood, which He shed for us, which in the institution of this supper, He said, is the blood of the covenant, which is shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. We thank you that we can have that covenant with you, that our Lord Jesus has offered the one-time sacrifice on the basis of which we can ever come to you in penitent and contrite spirit and know that we will be forgiven. Means everything to us to know that chapter 15, Paul shows that our enemy, death, is also Christ's enemy. The last one, he says, to be defeated, of course, that is with the resurrection of all from the dead. Therefore, because he has been victorious, our resurrection is also assured. Listen to this picture that Paul gives us of Christ, the first fruits, implying others to be harvested later. We'll be singing about that in just a moment. But now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who are asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ all shall be made alive, but each in his own order. Christ, the first fruits. After that, those who are Christ at his coming. Then comes the end, when he delivers up the kingdom to God and Father, when he has established all rule and all authority and power. That picture of Jesus as the first fruits and we as the harvest is beautifully portrayed in this next song. I don't think we've ever sung it here, but you'll find it easy enough to sing it. It is sung to the tune of Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. We all know that melody from Ode to Joy. Beethoven's Ode to Joy. And it just simply takes this passage and brings it alive with this picture of Christ the first fruits and we the harvest arising to be with him. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hearts to heaven.
Hallelujah.
And the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then we who are alive the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. It will all be fulfilled in what we sing sometimes, as in the morning of joy.
When the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall arise, and the slender's immortal shall envelop the skies, when the angel of death shall no longer destroy, and the dead shall awake in the morning of joy, in the morning of joy. Send his son.
Because he lives.
show your faith in the working of God by submitting to Him in baptism, remembering the words of the Apostle Peter. And corresponding to that, baptism saves you, not the removal of dirt from the flesh, but an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is at the right hand of God, having gone into heaven after angels and authorities and powers have been subjected to Him. I hope that everyone can sing this song with all of their heart. I believe in Jesus. That you believe with all of your heart that He is the Son of God, that He is the risen Savior, and that He is coming again. And if we can assist you this morning in obeying His message, we hope that you'll let us as we stand and sing this final hymn.
I believe in the one that called Jesus. I believe He still stormed Galilee. I believe that He walked on the water. And I believe that He's the answer for me. Yes, I believe.
Christ came for a reason, and that reason was to do away with sin. For those who are obedient to Him and have their sins washed away through His blood. We're thankful, Father, that we are part of that blood-bought institution, His church, and that we can have that great hope of heaven. We thank You for this uplifting service, Father, this time together to praise You and glorify You. For everything has been pleasing in Your sight, and that You were truly glorified as You ought to be. Be with our sick, Father, and lift them up and strengthen them. Forgive us of any sins that are upon us, Father. Help us always walk in the way that's right, to one day heaven might be our home. It's in Christ's name we ask it, Father. Amen. Yeah. Good this morning. Everyone sounding good. Very good. People looking out, it's home, folks. I don't see any visitors today. Please look in the bulletin. Karen's got a lengthy list of those that we need our prayers, suffering in various ways. She does a good job keeping those updated very well, so we're thankful for that. Don't have any additions to the list that is in the bulletin, but if you know of any, let me know. We'll get them on the list for this evening. Brother Marshall Brown did give us a thank you note upon the death of his father. And it reads, "Your many expressions of love and concern for me at this difficult time have meant so much. Your kind words, prayers, calls, and cards have lifted my spirits when I needed it most. Your encouragement is much appreciated and will be long remembered. My dad, Jack Brown, would have been so glad to see you reach out to me at this time. God bless all of you." Marshall Brown. We'll post that on the board in the back. I appreciate Marshall's thoughts on that. Thank you for reaching out to him with your love and concern. September calendars are in the back. If you'd like to get a copy of one of those, several of you follow that, and that's good. Anything else we need to mention this morning? So thankful that Mark was able to stand up here and put that good effort forth, and we praise God that they found his problem soon enough, and he's doing well.